schools. Anyone can participate, so bring friends, family, and coworkers to this one-of-a-kind fundraising event.
Texas Document Solutions.
A few years ago, Global Financial Partners in Huntsville decided to go with Sharp Copier printers from Texas Document Solutions. Partner, Brian Mastin.
One of the best decisions we've ever made.
Why?
It's made our office run so much more smoothly. I am so much more efficient and don't have to worry about the printer and the scanner and the copier. It just does what it should do when it should do it.
Texas Document Solutions. Better technology, better pricing, better customer care. That all has its benefits.
We can get done what we need to when we need to.
Brian, would you recommend Texas Document Solutions to others?
Yes.
Because?
Because they've been great for us, and they'll be great for them, too.
Things not so great with your document imaging vendor? Switch to Sharp Copier Printers from Texas Document Solutions. It's easy to do. Call 979-775-5500. 979-775-5500.
Texas Document Solutions.
979-775-5500.
Over 50,000 police officers are assaulted on the job each year, leading to injuries and death. This is the reality they deal with when making contact with the public. Another reality is that if someone doesn't comply with a lawful order or uses force against them, police may have to use sufficient force in response to obtain compliance. Use of force is always ugly. Nobody likes it, especially police, and nobody knows how it will turn out. Spread the word. For de-escalation to work, both parties must de-escalate. And de-escalation isn't necessary if there is no escalation. Help police by not escalating. Don't attack or try to disarm an officer. Whether it's getting asked a question, getting a citation, or getting arrested, don't argue, don't resist, don't flee. After the encounter has been resolved is the time to address any complaints. Comply now, complain later. Keep everybody safe. This message brought to you by the National Police Association. To learn more about how to help law enforcement accomplish its goals, visit nationalpolice.org.
Aggieland, this is your home for Texas A&M baseball. It's only 1150 AM and 93.7 FM. You're listening to KZNE College Station Bryan.
From WTAW, I'm Chelsea Reber with a news update on The Zone. A person was struck by a train in the Northgate District yesterday around 3:30 in the morning. A Union Pacific spokesman says the person is hospitalized in Temple with life-threatening injuries. No one on the train was hurt. College Station police report a 22-year-old man was struck near Welburn and Church. Huntsville police arrest two men following weekend gunfire where two men died and two others are hospitalized in critical condition. Officers responded Saturday during the midnight hour to a large house party a block south of Sam Houston State Soccer Stadium. A pair of 18-year-olds were killed, James Jones of Huntsville and Cruz Garcia of Livingston. Two men from Livingston were arrested, one for aggravated assault with a deadly weapon and the other for misdemeanor assault. College Station police report on social media Saturday morning being involved in a pursuit of the person driving a stolen vehicle. A male juvenile whose age was not released was caught following a brief foot chase. He was taken to juvenile detention following his arrest for unauthorized use of a motor vehicle and evading arrest twice. CSPD did not release whether the vehicle was unlocked and or the engine was running when it was stolen from the Woodlands Apartments. This is the last month eligible households can receive emergency SNAP benefits that were implemented during the pandemic. Shannon Avila, Programs Director at the Brazos Valley Food Bank, discussed how this will impact the food bank and its partners.
Combined with food supply constraints and inflation and the overall need in the Brazos Valley, we expect that this reduction in SNAP benefits, that means less resources for the individual household, which means that they will likely visit food pantries more.
Health Promotions Manager Mariah Suora reminds people who are losing the emergency benefits to check what other benefits they might be eligible for by going online to yourtexasbenefits.com. For more news, go online to WTAW.com. I'm Chelsea Reber on The Zone.
Everybody's talking about regenerative medicine now because, well, it works and because people who have joint pain are getting real, lasting relief without drugs or surgery. Hey, it's David Nuño, and QC Kinetics is the nation's leader in this exciting treatment. They use highly concentrated healing agents from your own body to restore and repair damaged joint tissue. If you've got ongoing joint pain from arthritis or injury, you need to call QC Kinetics. Don't assume that steroids and surgery are your only option. Times of change and regenerative medicine can get you moving again with no downtime. Stop taking taking the pain meds and discover the remarkable alternative that pro athletes have been using for years. Thanks to QC Kinetics, this amazing treatment option is now available for folks just like you and me who are sick and tired of joint pain. Don't put this off any longer. Spring is coming. You want to enjoy all that life has got to offer. Call QC Kinetics now. Get a free consultation with a local medical professional. That's QC Kinetics, 979-452-6000. That's 979-452-6000. QC Kinetics, 979-452-6000.
Good morning, sports fans. I'm Sean Burnett with your Aggie Sports Minute on the Zone. This update is brought to you by Hilco Metal Roofing and Supply. Call 936-825-0500 or click hilcosupply.com. Texas A&M men's basketball got a big win at home against Georgia Saturday night. After the game, Coach Buzz Williams said he was impressed with the way his team responded after the loss to Arkansas.
I thought we were even better than normal and one day before yesterday. I thought we had great energy at shoot-around today. And so it's been 13 days since we've played a game, and the game was our actual fourth rep. And I thought that that was visible in how we played on both ends of the floor tonight. I thought there was great connectivity, cohesiveness, symmetry, whatever words you want to use in those adjectives, not just offensively, but defensively.
The guys will get their second run at Auburn Tuesday night with a 6 o'clock tip, and you can hear that game on 1620-94.5 WTAW. Aggie women's basketball took number 3 LSU to the brink, but couldn't quite get it done in a 72-66 loss Sunday. Head coach Joni Taylor after the game on the process moving forward.
Every single day, are we better today than we were yesterday? And if we continue to do that, will the outcome be this year what we want? No. But our players understand that they're laying the foundation for years to come, and that's what our focus is.
And that's your Aggie Sports Minute, brought to you by Hilco Metal Roofing and Supply. On The Zone, I'm Sean Burnett.
Looking for podcasts of TexAgs Radio, The Louis Belina Show, or Chip Howard? Look inside the Pause Center at Zone1150.com. Don't miss a single rant, guest, or moment. You can download or subscribe to any and all of your favorite shows inside the Pause Center at Zone1150.com. There's also a special selection where you can find select interviews from David, Louis, and Chip. Look up Zone Interviews inside the Pause Center at Zone1150.com. Download or subscribe, but don't miss out. Check out the Pause Center at Zone1150.com.
If I'm gonna do this, I'll need my news team at my side.
News team! Assemble!
Howdy, Aggieland. Welcome to the SEC.
You know, our program will be built on 4 principles in which I talk about all the time. Toughness, effort, discipline, and pride.
Dang it! I'm going to have to buy that boy cream cone.
And now I'm distracted on my point. What were we talking about?
It's bull crap. All I care about is winning. Show me the dang baby.
You do it till they do it right. And then you do it till they can't do it wrong.
Go get him! Why are you dancing right around? Eat him like he's a steak.
He fits what TexAgs Radio is about. He fits into what the listeners are going to want. He's a pro on every level.
It's Nuño and the crew on TexAgs Radio. Right here on Sports Radio 1150 AM and 93.7 FM. The Zone.
Hey, hit records on my demo. Did y'all boys not get the memo?
All right, Aggie Hoops, you came in the door waving the 4-4, and all you heard was, please don't hurt me no more. That's exactly what the Aggies have done to a lot of, I would say, inferior opponents or opponents that should be at their level. When a good team comes to take on the Aggies find a way to take care of business very early. We saw it not only against Georgia, we saw it against South Carolina, we saw it against Missouri, and even though Auburn is one of the better teams in the SEC, we saw it against Auburn on the road, by the way, a team that the Aggs are going to see very, very soon. It is TexAgs Radio. We are presented by David Gardner's Jewelers. We are here in the Rollo Insurance Studio. It is the Go Hour presented by the Warehouse at CC Creations. It is me, David Nuño, and Olin Buchanan, our Heisman Trophy voter, our columnist, and our swag dad. What's up, bro?
You know, just been enjoying this nice weather that we had this weekend.
I heard you mention 2 days of nice weather. I remember one day of nice weather.
I thought Saturday was really nice.
Well, I was in I was more in Austin, so it was not good in Austin.
Especially to be February.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was very nice.
I didn't like it. But I did like yesterday quite a bit.
Yeah.
Yesterday was awesome. Let's talk a little bit about Saturday night. You were there for it all. Mm-hmm. Like, you heard me at the top of the show. When there's a team that is perceived to be around A&M's level or below, since conference play has begun, the Aggies take care of business. Now, I know Vanderbilt was a close game, right? And they grinded it out. And I'm not saying they're going to blow out every team that they play. But I expect them to take care of business early and often against teams that are at their level or slightly below.
Usually, especially at home, yep. Right? There were all kinds of factors involved in the loss at Arkansas.
Yep.
Kentucky, they were on the road, and Kentucky was just getting its footing, hadn't lost. But, yeah, A&M went out. That was a complete dismantling of Georgia.
But how many times have we said that this year? Like, I feel like we say that a lot.
I said that against Auburn.
South Carolina?
Bad team.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Missouri, expected to make the tournament.
Did not dismantle them, but
pretty close.
Well, remember, it looked like they were going to dismantle.
Yeah, and then
Missouri
it got within
four, and then A&M had to, you know.
But they ended up winning by, like, what, 18 maybe?
Was it that much? I guess it was.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was – well, that was ebb and flow type of thing.
I'm going to go back just because I might be wrong. I'm
pretty
sure.
It might have been like that. Yeah, it might have been.
It was a beatdown. Missouri, let's see, 82-64.
Okay, it wasn't a beatdown.
See, I feel like it was except for that little stretch.
But you have to include that little stretch.
But that's basketball.
You sound like the guys who were on the NCAA selection committee last year.
I sound like them. Goodness gracious. No, to me, it was a beatdown because, yes, they won by 18. And they were the better team for 92% of the game.
They were.
And the better team, and we're thinking about it, what, a month ago? A better team in the fact that it was just a little stretch
that
by Missouri.
That was, I would say, so far, their second most impressive win.
Missouri?
Yeah.
Auburn, number one?
Number one.
Yeah.
And, you know, they've you know what? Quite frankly, maybe the second best win was at Florida.
Maybe.
You know, I mean,
start off conference play like that. Yeah.
And Florida's pretty good, actually. But it's been such a fun ride. And
you know which one was not impressive, but at the time felt impressive?
LSU.
Yep. I mean, they won by 13. It's impressive. You beat anybody conference and, opponent by
double
digits.
Figures, right.
But of all the games, that was a team that I thought was really good when they played them. They turned out to not be really good. And then you look at the Florida game was close, but they grinded that one. They destroyed LSU. They, in my opinion, destroyed Missouri. They absolutely, if I use destroyed for Missouri, what's the word we use for South Carolina?
Annihilate.
They grinded out another victory against Florida. They were the better team for a big percentage of the game against Kentucky. They just couldn't close the deal, and Kentucky was better at the end. They annihilated Auburn.
They annihilated them.
I needed a better word. They grinded against Vanderbilt.
Yeah.
They had not their best performance against Arkansas, yet had a chance to win. Not a chance to win, but they were within four with a few minutes left.
They did, with all kinds of factors involved.
And then Georgia. I mean, run after run after run. And three-point shot and defense and run after run.
I think Georgia led 2-1, and then A&M went like on a 10-0 run and never looked back.
Yep.
It was a fun game to watch. I wasn't sure. I even asked Buzz Williams this, and I don't think he knew. Maybe he didn't have an opinion. But were you more impressed by what A&M did on the offensive end in that game or on the defensive end? Because they got it done on both ends in a big way. Shot 50%.
I may ask him that today.
9 three-pointers. Shot 50% overall. And that's with – they shot 50% overall, and that's with Buzz doing something coaches never do. Emptying the bench with 9.5 minutes left in the game.
And still winning by a lot.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. Dude.
In fact, the Eric Pratt kid comes off the bench, bombs 2 of 3 three-pointers, and the third one almost went.
Yeah.
That guy might need to play. it was, gosh, what a complete and thorough domination. Now, and Buzz will tell you this, and he mentioned it, and it's true. Georgia was without its best player, Kerry Roberts. But I don't think it would have mattered.
It didn't feel like it would matter, but it does. But I don't care.
I mean, maybe you win by 20 instead of 25.
But this is the way I look at it. A&M unfortunately got Kentucky when they were figuring stuff out.
Yeah.
Okay.
They were showing signs even before A&M got there.
They got Arkansas as they looked like they were trying to figure things out. They had that loss to Baylor, but they had won a couple before that. So you know what? I'll take a little bit of help in whatever form it comes. Just stack wins on wins. Get this team to the tournament.
Yeah. Well, I think that tomorrow night's game against Auburn is going to be very key to that. If they win that game, then I'm predicting no worse than 13-5.
Yep.
In SEC play, if they win that game. And quite frankly, why wouldn't I pick A&M when you've beaten Auburn by 16 on their floor? Why wouldn't you expect A&M to win at home?
Have you beat them three straight times, or am I wrong about that?
I think you're actually right about that. I was there for that win in Tampa.
We know what they did this year.
And I think
they beat them at the end of the regular season last year, but I might be off. But regardless, the way this team is playing.
You reckon Auburn's going to be defensively focused on Boots Radford?
I think they will.
After he put 30 up on them?
Well, but you know what? They can do that with the way Henry Coleman has played in his last four games.
Well, I know this. In his last three games, he's averaging 17 points. In his last
he had
three
one
games.
Game, I think he had nine in the four. I'll take nine, by the way.
Yeah, sure.
Heck yeah. And it has been nice because Julius Marble hasn't had the output that he had when he had his little run. So this is one of those examples of this A&M team, the way they're built is, while I like them having a go-to guy, and I think that guy is Boots, they have guys who can step up and deliver a 15-point performance. And if it's not Henry, it could be Julius. If it's not Julius, it might be somebody else. It could be Dexter Dennis.
I'm still waiting on that game where Henry Coleman has that double-double, and it's like 12 points and 10 rebounds, right? And Julius makes about at least 50% of his shots and finishes with 10 to 12 points, right? And Dexter Dennis makes a couple of threes and scores about 10 points.
Yep.
And Wade Taylor hits, I don't know, three of four three-pointers and finishes with 15, and Boots does what he does and finishes with 15. And in the same game, Hefner comes off the bench and hits a couple of threes because that's what he does. Mm-hmm. And then, you get some trash points from Garcia and Solomon, and you have that one game where everybody, maybe not going off, but everybody is playing a good, solid game. Everybody. And what A&M does. Maybe they're saving that for Tennessee and Alabama.
Hey, look, just keep it going. It's fun. I'm not expecting them to win every single game. We've said that before. But this team, there's no reason that they don't have a chance to win every single game that they go to. And this is not the same team that we saw in conference play. They're just not.
Non-conference play?
Yeah, sorry, non-conference play. Yeah. They're not the same team.
No, same guys, but not the same team. We've all known. They figured things out. They had that time after Christmas to really focus on what they were doing wrong and what they were doing right and really iron out all the wrinkles. And, man, it's like they got extra starch now. There's no wrinkles.
This is the team that we've seen in SEC play that I think we expected to see in non-conference play. And probably a little better than I expected, to be honest with you.
Well, this is a team that we expected to see when A&M was ranked number 23 or 24 early in the year.
Yep.
They're playing like a team that should be ranked 23 or 24, if not better.
Yep. If you'd like to be a part of the conversation, you can text us on the A&B text line 979-693-1150 or call us. What do you think about this Aggie basketball team? Are they making the tournament? They have not updated, at least as of this morning at 5 a.m., they had not updated bracketology since before the game. The last check on February 3rd had the Aggies as the first four out on ESPN and also on CBS. They still got a long way to go in the season, so it doesn't matter where they are. But I have to feel very good about their if they beat Auburn, there's no first four out. They're in.
You wouldn't think.
At this point, right?
I know. It just seems to me Lenardi's one of those guys that just, for whatever reason, is never, I don't know, never looks at A&M seriously until he has to.
Until he has to, yep.
Now, maybe that's unfair, but that's the way it seems to me.
At least from our perspective, yes. So, again, the text line, AMB text line, 979-693-1150, AMB, a College Station branch of the Amarillo National Bank, Good Texas Banking, the website amb.com. Let's go behind the glass. Nick Savage, good morning, sir.
Good morning, y'all. How you doing?
I'm good, man. How are you? Well,
good. Nuño, you finally got your low-stress game, right? Did you enjoy watching this game? You weren't all crazy,
no,
all stressed
but
out?
You know what the interesting thing is? This team has given us a few of those, right? Like, they do give us some stressful games. Sure, Florida's stressful. Vanderbilt was stressful, no doubt. And that was a week ago Saturday. So, but they have given us the Missouris and the Missouri did get stressful for a little
bit. It did get stressful.
For a little bit, yeah. But they've given us Georgia, South Carolina, like Auburn. So they've given us a lot of these as well. So I thank them for my mental health.
Yeah, absolutely. And hey, y'all kind of stole my graphic idea. I had a graphic made specifically for this, but I've been really impressed with Henry Coleman. I looked at the past three games against Vandy, Arkansas, and Georgia.
18-18-15.
Yeah, 18-18-15. He's been really impressive with the rebounds. Shooting not too bad either, so... I wanted to selfishly save that for when I brought it up, but credit to y'all. He's been playing lights out, so credit to him.
He deserved, because look, let's be very honest. There was a stretch of the season where he was struggling.
Absolutely,
and we talked about it.
Yeah. Again, I think Henry's that guy that doesn't go out there. In fact, I know he doesn't go out there thinking, okay, I got to get my points tonight. Yeah. He goes out there and says, okay, on this particular play, what has to be done for the team to be successful on this particular, do I need to set this screen?
Yeah.
You know, do I need to get over here and be here for this rebound? Do I, you know, whatever. And I think the game, Henry Coleman, at least to my untrained eye, strikes me as the guy that just, everything that he gets is just what comes to him naturally in the flow of the game. Not trying to force anything.
Sure.
Letting the game come to him.
On the opposite side, I think Wade Taylor kind of takes the game, which is what his role is, right, to kind of take the game. He's still struggling to shoot the ball. He was 2 of 8 from three. But I feel like he's, I don't know if trending in the right direction is the right way to phrase it. He's due. How about that? He's due to have a 3-for-4 game from behind the three.
Yeah, he had a 3-for-5 against somebody, I can't even remember who, before the Arkansas game, but – but he's been struggling of late from three-point range. Now, here's what I like about him, though. We all know that he can go into a game and go 4-for-4 from three-point.
Yep.
He has that ability. And I want to see him attack the basketball, I mean, the basket even more, and dish or draw fouls. Because when he draws a foul, it's a layup. He doesn't miss at the free throw line. So I probably just jinxed him. But I like Wade Taylor at the free throw line. I like him attacking the basket. And, you know, when he shoots the three, you feel like
he's got a good chance.
That's got a great chance. But, you know, he's just been a little bit erratic of late.
All right, let's hit a break. I know we got to go to Kay Nagley there at the News and Social Center. We'll do that when we come back. Plus, I want to talk about the turning point. And by the way, there's maybe one or two turning points in that game because it was over pretty early. But there's two different examples I have in my mind. I'd like for you to think about your turning point in the game there against Georgia. And by the way, Auburn tomorrow, quickly. Right now, let's talk about Caldwell Country Chevrolet, Highway 21 in Caldwell, online at CaldwellCountryChevrolet.com. They got the deals, they got the service, they got the people. That's what they have there at Caldwell Country Chevrolet. Drove by it yesterday on my way back from the Austin area. Zach Hester. He holds his crew to very high standards, and if you've experienced it, you'll know what I'm talking about. You're thinking to yourself right now, yeah, that's true. That's what they do there at Caldwell Country. If you haven't and you're thinking about buying a new vehicle, if you're in the market or you're going to be in the market, really consider Caldwell Country Chevrolet because they are a small-town dealer in the Brazos Valley, but they're making big dreams possible there. No doubt about that. They got an amazing client list as well. Dante Haw, Billy Lucci, R.C. Slocum. R.C. only gets his cars there from Caldwell Country Chevrolet. They're a short drive away, 15 minutes, Brian and Caldwell, short conversation away, but you'll see the difference when you step on the lot and you do business with Zach and the fellas there at Caldwell Country Chevrolet. Highway 21 in Caldwell, online at CaldwellCountryChevrolet.com.
I'm Chelsea Reber with your community calendar on The Zone. Silver Tops will be held Tuesday night in honor of three Aggies who died recently. The ceremony begins at 10:30 p.m. in the Academic Plaza. Registration is now open for Harvey Little League. Register your kid or be a Harvey sponsor by going online to brianharveylittleleague.com. The deadline is February 16th. Hardcore Dynamics, a Texas A&M co-ed a cappella group, presents Acapalooza at Rudder Auditorium on Saturday, February 18th at 6 p.m. Find the event with a ticket link on WTAW's community calendar at WTAW.com. Stage Center Theater in downtown Bryan presents Sleuth. Performances run February 9th through the 25th. Purchase your tickets online at stagecenter.net. Listen to the NFL playoffs on 1150 AM and 93.7 FM, thanks to Hungry Howie's. You can hear the divisional round, championship weekend, and the Super Bowl every game on The Zone. That's your community calendar. I'm Chelsea Reber on The Zone.
If you or someone you know wants to earn $100,000 per year or more, plus annual bonuses, LSP Transport is looking for drivers with a strong work ethic to be part of their successful team. LSP Transport is seeking Class A CDL drivers with at least 2 years of experience. If you're a Class A CDL driver looking for a better opportunity or know someone that is, visit www.lspt.jobs now, as these high-paying positions are limited. LSP Transport, an equal opportunity employer.
If you have a debit card, you're used to spending money. But what if your card actually ended up earning you money? That's not exactly normal, but that's what you can get at A&B. It's called Kasasa Cashback Checking. Don't mind the weird name. What you need to know is that it's a free account with cash rewards. Use your debit card for everyday purchases, and we'll pay you cash back every month. If that doesn't sound like normal banking, well, guess what? We're not a normal bank. So contact A&B today and ask for Kasasa or visit anb.com. Equal housing lender, member FDIC.
Maroon U is your ultimate stop for brand name apparel, gifts, and accessories for the entire family. From Columbia, 47 Brand, Yeti, Dooney & Burke, and Adidas, we're able to outfit you for every occasion. Visit Maroon U and our family of companies on Holloman Drive in College Station to shop the latest in brand name Aggie merchandise. Shop Maroon U today, voted best in the Brazos' best gift shop since 2016. Maroon never looks so good with Maroon U.
Keyshawn, J. Will, and Max.
This guy says he doesn't drink coffee, yet he has espresso martinis. It's not
yeah,
the
what's
same.
The espresso in there for, Key? It's to keep you
it's
awake.
It's to keep you awake. You're having caffeine.
So what is a caramel
like
macchiato
morning.
That's not coffee?
What is it?
Yeah, it is. Is there coffee?
It's a style
macchiato?
Of coffee.
It's $6 is what it is.
I'll take a small caramel macchiato. That'd be $13, sir.
Spend your mornings with Keyshawn, J. Will, and Max, powered by WC Tractor. Mornings from 5 to 8 here on The Zone.
All right, we're back. TexAgs Radio, presented by David Gardner's Jewelers here on the Rollo Insurance Studio. It is the Go Hour, presented by the Warehouse at CC Creations, OB, myself, and Kay Nagley there at the News and Social Center. Kay Nagley.
Good morning, guys. How are y'all?
Good morning. How are you?
Good. I went to the game as a fan this weekend. It was actually fun to just, you know, yeah. Sit back and watch. And I'm also so happy to see Reed packed. It's fun seeing, you know, us kind of turn into a basketball school for a little bit.
It was well, I think... I've been here during some really good times, mm-hmm. as you have as well, OB. I think it is not a basketball school, but they become a basketball school when the team is good.
Well, basketball is the ultimate bandwagon sport. Mm-hmm. And they're like the field of dreams. You build it, you build me a winning team, a team capable of going to postseason, and then they'll come. But you got to build it first.
Yeah.
You're not. Oh, let me hijack this just for a minute. So I'm flipping through the channels yesterday, not much on. And I came across the A&M LSU basketball game, the women's game.
Okay.
Which I'm stunned because it's in the fourth quarter and it's a game.
It's a game, yeah.
And I wish that I was watching this game with Logan, because a lot of times I'll complain about officials call and Logan having been an official say, no, this is why you're wrong. Anyway, I was okay.
Okay,
all
thank
right.
you.
About if you have access to that game, go back is it between 5.5 and 5 minutes, right? LSU – this girl shoots and misses, and on the replay, I'm watching it, and she's number 10, and she, it appears to me, pushes, I mean, literally takes her right arm and pushes the A&M player out of the way. I mean, not just, you know, pushes, I'm saying extends the arm.
An extension.
And then goes over what appears to be going over the back.
Not allowed.
Of the A&M player that did have position to get the rebound. Foul call on A&M.
How is that even possible?
And I'm thinking, okay, I know we talk about how bad officiating is, but that to me set a new level of ineptitude.
Yeah.
Now, maybe I'm looking at it all wrong, and I admit I'm always biased toward A&M, but somebody, if you, I bet you some people listen, there's a few, more than a few people that know exactly what I'm talking about. Somebody tell me why I'm wrong on that.
Well, you know what the beauty of TexAgs is? We have interns, and we have access to Logan Lee. Somebody can go get that play exactly, text it to Logan.
It's about
Logan can respond within minutes.
Between 5.5 to 5 minutes.
Somewhere in the 5 minutes.
Left
minute
in
range.
The game in the fourth quarter.
All right. Find that play and somebody in the back if they can. And Nick, I know you're busy.
I know if I was Joni Taylor, I'd have been teed up and probably kicked out.
She's the best.
Well, she's a lot classier than I am, but who isn't?
Well, this is true. Who is it? Kay, this is back to your segment. Hello.
Hello. So, I mean, OB is kind of stealing my thunder here with the women's basketball. No, I'm kidding. But Texas A&M was within range of the undefeated LSU Tigers at Reed Arena yesterday, but failed to grab a hold of their second conference victory. Sahara Jones, who had 14 points, they nearly blemished LSU's perfect record in the second half. The Aggies will now head on the road to take on Mississippi State this Sunday.
Let's get another win. They're playing much better.
Yeah, they are. Well, they got some players now.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, not that they didn't have, but they got more. You know, they got a bench.
They got an array.
Not everybody's having to, you know, by the fourth quarter, their tongues are dragging. They're right. So fatigued.
What else, Kay?
Fighting Texas Aggie softball starts this week.
What? Did you swing the stick the other day?
I did not. I did not go.
So
no.
They had a, did you see?
Yeah, I know.
Did you go?
No.
Oh.
There were some people making contact, but I did not. Get to attend.
Back in the day when I covered Cat Osterman, I always say I never covered Texas softball, I covered Cat Osterman. And they offered the media a chance to swing the bat again. I said no. Now there's all these TV guys, of course, they're on and they're trying to and you know, they're flailing away and looking silly. I'm like, I know I'm not going to hit it. Why don't I even bother? I don't need to be a spectacle. In fact, if anyone would have had a chance to hit it, much like this week or this weekend, it would have been somebody like me that, you know, doesn't think they can hit it. So the person that thinks they can hit it is
trying to swing for the fences.
Or just trying to make it. To me, it'd be like, okay, I missed it so bad, I hit it.
Right.
If that makes any sense.
So this is where Billy will make fun of me. But
this is where.
Well, he's got a lot of places. I will not do that without 2 weeks of preparation. I'm going to the batting cages. I am focused every day. Yeah, I don't just go out there.
And still not hit it.
Yeah, I still won't hit it. No, but I will at least mentally have to put myself in a position to feel like I've done the work to go do something that I've never done.
Yeah, I think people clown on me enough for me, just being me, for me not to ask for it.
Right. It just comes.
Yeah.
What else, Kay?
Let me pull this back up. Yeah, so as I said earlier, softball starts this weekend. They will play Tarleton State on Thursday. We'll have our very own Kennedy Cavan covering that game.
The Cavster.
Yeah, she'll be there. And then both Fridays, a doubleheader, Northern Kentucky, Tarleton State again. Saturday, Michigan State and Texas A&M Commerce. And then Sunday, Texas A&M Commerce as well. So excited to get the Trisha Ford era underway.
Yeah, we're pumped about that. We'll be having her here a couple times a month starting, I believe, next week. This one's for you, OB. Forrest and Wellican, who's a huge Nuño fan, says, as it's loading up, OB on the radio, Katie Lee said in the women's basketball, going over the back is legal.
Okay. Well, you can't when has that been, right?
I don't remember that ever being.
But there's still contact, and the girl from A&M looked like she, to me, had position. But that still doesn't excuse the fact that she shoved the first girl out of the way. But, again, I don't, you know. I'm not an expert on basketball officiating, that's for sure.
Well, Jimmy Snyder on the YouTube page says there were several questionable calls like that in the women's game yesterday, OB. So apparently there was a lot of that. That's unfortunate. So I will say hello to the folks on YouTube. Hello to the folks at the CW. Hey, KBTX friends. Also say hello to the Zone. You are listening to TexAgs Radio presented by David Gardner's Jewelers. When we come back, OB, two things I want to get into. You have a tidbit, a factoid.
A factoid.
I want to also talk a little bit about the turning point of this game.
Okay.
And then Alabama has got some coordinators now, and people are responding to that. So we'll talk about that. But right now, Milliken Reserve Time, Farm to Table Community in College Station. Obi, did you know? You might not know. They got homes out there?
Yeah, they do.
Did you know that?
I do.
Okay. You know
my, my son dated a girl who lived out there, so I actually went out there and saw it.
You know they have trails?
Yeah.
Did you know that? Yeah.
I do.
Farms?
Yeah, yeah.
Wide open spaces?
Wide open spaces, like a Dixie Chick song.
I think they're called the Chicks now. I think they've dropped the
Dixie. You know what? When they had that song, they were the Dixie Chicks.
2,600 acres of open space farms and 30 miles of trails. An extensive network of trails throughout a wooded landscape. And they got all the animals. Any animal you can think of that they have?
Love animals. They got rabbits.
They make what kind
of turtles? Well, rabbits, I don't know. Oh, okay, yeah.
And something like that. Never. Turtles?
Snap, I don't know.
Songbirds? See? I know that this is making you say, you know what? I don't have to go to Millican Reserve. I just need to listen to TexAgs Radio to feel like I'm in nature. But you should go check it out. The website, MillicanReserve.com. Again, that website, MillicanReserve.com.
He's got the moves. With the wit of Larry David.
What are you doing here?
Olin Buchanan, mornings at 8 on TexAgs Radio, here on The Zone.
What I would tell people is that you don't have to be in pain anymore.
Meet Dr. Justin Garzone, medical director at QC Kinetics, the nation's leader in using advanced regenerative medicine to give people lasting relief from chronic joint pain.
What's exciting is that I get to see patients with our treatments actually get better.
Have you discovered regenerative medicine? It's an all-natural way to use the power of your own body to restore and repair damaged tissue.
We're using things that are already in your body, and we're simply concentrating them and then put it in an area of your body that you're having the pain so that your body can start the regenerative process, the healing process.
For pain in your knees, hips, back, shoulders, don't assume the old treatments are the only treatments. Avoid drugs and surgery and get lasting relief. Call QC Kinetics now for a free consultation.
Call QC Kinetics 979-452-6000. That's 979-452-6000. 979-452-6000.
It's back and better than ever. Chili Fest 2023, presented by Miller Lite, is headed to Snook, Texas, March 31st and April 1st for 2 days of live music and the kind of fun you can only have in Aggieland. This year with Saturday performances by The Weathered Souls, Jacob Stelly, Colton Moore, and The Clever Few. You need to know this ain't forever. And headliner Whiskey Myers. Performances by Tyler Halverson, Carson Jeffrey, Giovanni and the Hired Guns, Muscadine Bloodline, and headliner Jamie Johnson. Should have seen it in color. Get your tickets online now at chilifest.org, plus camping, team information, and more. Chili Fest 2023, presented by Miller Lite. Miller Brewing Company. Great beer, great responsibility. 21 means 21.
If you have a debit card, you're used to spending money. But what if your card actually ended up earning you money? That's not exactly normal, but that's what you can get at A&B. It's called Kasasa Cashback Checking. Don't mind the weird name. What you need to know is that it's a free account with cash rewards. Use your debit card for everyday purchases, and we'll pay you cash back every month. If that doesn't sound like normal banking, well, guess what? We're not a normal bank. So contact A&B today and ask for Kasasa or visit anb.com. Equal housing lender, member FDIC.
It's Larry from Shelby, previously on the Paul Feinbaum Show.
Paul, I want to, whatever happened to that guy that used to call in from New Jersey to talk real fast? I don't hear from him anymore either. What happened to him?
AC?
Yeah, what happened to him?
I'm hoping he's been extradited back to wherever he's from.
It's the Paul Feinbaum Show, powered by Polaris Fun Center. 2 to 4 weekdays on The Zone.
Thought there was great connectivity, cohesiveness, symmetry, whatever words you want to use in those adjectives, not just offensively, but defensively. And I think what's happening is I think the young adults are holding the older adults accountable because they are receiving understanding, continuing to execute at a higher level the game plan that the staff has given them. They're very accountable for their work. And you can tell that the relationships that those guys have off the floor are bleeding to on the floor.
Interesting stuff there. So if I'm understanding it correctly, the young guys are kind of like leading the way. Could you imagine a scenario where A&M football says the same thing this year? Because they got some great veterans, right? They obviously, Damani, Anias. Imagine A&M football also getting a lot of that leadership from the second-year players and maybe even some first-year players.
I hope so. I just wonder who the young guys he's talking about are.
I guess Wade is still considered a young guy, right?
Yes.
Yeah, Henry's not a young guy. Julius is not a young guy.
I mean, he knows his team better
Dexter's
than I do.
Dexter's not a young
Boots.
Guy. Yeah.
He knows his team better than I do, but gosh, Boots Radford and Dexter Dennis and Henry Coleman don't strike me as guys that need to be held accountable by the younger guys. But he, like I said, he knows the team better than I do. Those just don't strike me as guys that – they strike me as guys that probably held themselves accountable.
Yep. Hey, it is TexAgs Radio presented by David Gardner's Jewelers in the Rollo Insurance Studio. It is the Go Hour presented by the Warehouse at CC Creations. I got a text on the A&B text line on my personal phone that says, this is from Coach Kelly from the fan show, Kelly Adams. Over the back isn't a thing. It's not even in the rule book. The correct term is the principle of verticality.
Okay.
A player is entitled to the space directly above them all the way to the ceiling. A rebounder can jump and violate that principle as long as the player in the front does not try to take the space. So a tall player can jump and reach through the vertical plane of a ball without committing a foul.
Okay. From my biased, untrained perspective, again, we're still throwing out the idea that she pushed the first girl out of the
right.
way. From my untrained eye, it appeared that then the girl from LSU who came up from behind – what they use it? Some of the she vertically assaulted the A&M player.
The vertical assaultation.
And again, the foul was called on A&M, and I'm like, I don't get it. But it, okay, if I guess they made the right call.
Right.
It sure didn't look right to me though. Between 5.5 and 5 minutes.
Yep. Hey, let's quickly get into the turning point. Then I want to turn to some football thoughts. There's a couple different ones we can choose. I'll let you go first because you'll probably pick one of the ones that I have written down.
Okay, I'm going to say it occurred with 11:59 left in the first half.
Okay.
And here's what happened. A&M got out to a 15-2 lead. Georgia comes back. They hit a three-pointer in the corner. They get a couple of stops, get a couple of free throws. It's 15-7. A&M's still in control. But you're thinking, okay, is Georgia going to make this a game?
Right.
You know, we've seen teams get up early.
And, sure.
And then – A&M gets the ball inside to Henry Coleman, who looks like he's going to turn and make a move, but instead he passes out
yep.
to Boots Radford, top of the key, three-pointer. That three-pointer kicks off a 13-0 run. A&M's up 28-7. It's never a game again.
That 13-0 run, if I remember correctly, was after a 14-0 run, right?
Yes.
So I picked two different ones. It's 1-2, right? Or 2-1, however you want to phrase it, with Georgia leading, and A&M goes on this huge run. You had threes from Tyrese. You had threes from Wade. They go to the 15-2 lead. But to me, the turning point, and I kind of agree with you, because they did make it interesting at 15-7, but the Dexter Dennis dunk to make it 25-7. To me, that was at the end of a 10-0 run, if I remember correctly. I might be wrong there, but I believe it made it 25-7. That dunk by Dexter Dennis, which electrified the crowd, and they couldn't stop showing the highlights on TV, to me, was the turning point.
Actually, that was the end of a 13.
Was that the end of a 13-0 run?
Yeah.
Okay.
But
that made it 25-7, though? Am I right about that?
It made it 28-7.
Okay.
So their lead, they tripled their lead, right?
Yeah.
So it was 7-14-21. But to me, when I say the turning point, that run started with the Boots
three. Yeah.
And it's interesting to me because the more spectacular play is the dunk. And you go, holy cow.
Right. But it started.
I always like the three-pointers because I get one more point.
Yeah.
But, that whole run was the –
Because
that's when it went from, okay, Georgia's not getting back into this at all.
Right.
What a way to start it and finish it.
All right, hey, let's also do this. Let's do a little factoid time here on TexAgs Radio.
So I was working on a, something I'm going to be having out pretty soon about A&M football, and A&M only had 19 sacks last year. That's 20 fewer than they had the previous season, right? So that was a big, and coming into the season, that was a where's the pressure going to come from, and it didn't come. So when I get to the factoid, I want you to think of this not as an Aggie or college football. Think of it as only from an NFL fan's perspective.
NFL.
If you're only an NFL fan's perspective.
All right, my hands are over my eyes. Okay. I'm going to put my
– The last time A&M had fewer than 19 sacks in a season was 2008. They had 16. They had 16 sacks in 2008. And that 2008 defense included Von Miller and Michael Bennett.
Tell me more.
Well, Cyril Obazor had 3 sacks, and he was the second leading sacker that year. But think, Von Miller is one of the best pass rushers in
the NFL.
In the NFL history.
Right.
Now, I get it. He didn't blow up until like the next year. But still, when you just think of it, that Michael Bennett finished his NFL career with like 70 sacks. You go out and get 70 sacks in the NFL, you had 2 that year.
So what you're saying is potentially we can apply that thinking for Von, as you're saying here, with some of the guys we saw.
Well, I think so.
Yep.
I think the next year you saw Von break out. I think that maybe the next year he might have led the nation in sacks. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know that anybody on A&M's defense is going to lead the nation in sacks, but if there was one, if you were going to project somebody to go from, okay, kind of productive in a pass rush to being a dominant pass rusher.
Is it Fidel?
Fidel Diggs was looking pretty dang good.
He had that little 3-game stretch.
It took him a while to get started.
Yep.
But then he had the 2, and I think he forced fumbles on both of them.
He did.
Alabama. Then he had one against South Carolina before he got hurt.
Yep.
So Fidel Diggs?
Fidel Diggs, yeah.
Okay. You know who I liked? It was small, very small sound, but he was different. And I liked what I saw from Malik Siegler.
Oh, yeah. Heck yeah.
But it might be an inside guy. You know, what if Walter Nolan starts blowing? What if it's Gabriel Brown-Odindi, who we haven't even seen
yet? Yeah, we didn't see.
Or one of the Shamars.
But what you're saying here is there are options where this can come from. There's not just one guy that on that line that we could see having an 8 to 12 sack season. Like one of those guys potentially could emerge as that guy.
I think so. And I think that
or we'll take a lot from a lot.
And even you go look at Myles Garrett as a freshman. And he had 8 sacks. But then you look and see who they were against. And it may not strike you as being as impressive as you thought. The point I'm getting at is, then you see what he was as a sophomore and a junior. So there's a lot of reasons to look at, you know, all those freshmen that are still here. You know, the national media acts like nobody stayed. All those freshmen are still here. And to say, you know, I can't take it for granted that A&M's going to have this dominant pass rush in 2023. But let me look at some track records. Let me look at that shows that freshmen get better. You know, a lot of times it takes a while to learn how to rush the passer at the next level.
And I still believe my thinking, philosophy, whatever you want to call it, is that there were kids last year playing. Those were kids that looked like men, acted like men, and made men-like plays. But they were still 18-year-olds taking on a lot of 22-year-olds. Mm-hmm. A lot of those.
That were highly recruited guys in their own right and have had 2 and 3 years of SEC development.
As a lot of 4- or 5-star guys that they played against and played with, right? It takes you, hopefully, your freshman year, even if you're all world coming in, hopefully you're better your sophomore year, mm-hmm. and hopefully you're better your junior year.
That's
and you're competing
idea.
Against the same kind of guys. So I look at that offensive line and I think, look, yeah, well, there's some veterans on there, sure. But there are a lot of newbies out there making plays, right? Or going out there to play. On the defensive line, a lot of newbies in new roles. Guys that did not start, guys that were take a back seat to DeMarvin and whomever, right?
The whole left side of the line.
Right.
I mean, Trey Zun was a redshirt freshman who didn't play his freshman because he's hurt. Then he played hurt most of last year.
Yep.
Ended up with Jordan Moko hadn't played, and then he got hurt. So he ended up with Dewberry, who was I thought, pretty really good. And then Bryce Foster played, what, 2.5 games?
Yeah.
3.5 games? And the rest was a redshirt freshman center, Wyckoff. So the whole left side were guys playing for the first time.
And I also think guys like Fathery, who got better as the year went on, but he struggled a little bit in the beginning, and Layden Robinson. I think Layden's looking at this year as a prove-it year. Like, you know,
absolutely.
What? I had a down year for my standards because he was being mentioned as a potential top four-round pick guy, right?
He even has said it.
He has. He said it at a press conference. I think he's looking at this year like, okay, guys. So I was hoping that last year was going to be the revenge tour. It better be this year for some players personally and also for the team itself.
Yeah. Yeah, so anyway, I just thought, going back to what all started this, I just thought, I don't know if ironic is the right word, but very surprising that when you look at A&M, the last time they had 16 sacks, it was with Von Miller and Michael Bennett, two big-time NFL pass rushers.
Isn't it ironic that next on the show, we're going to listen to a lot of sports sets singing that same line. That, and we're going to get into some text. Do you know anything about Alanis Morissette?
Yeah, but I don't know the line you're talking about.
Isn't it ironic, don't you think?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, whatever the name of that song is, okay. We're coming back with that. Because I'm sure Kate Nagley, who knows everything from the 80s and 90s, jams that.
Well, she ought to know, since Alanis Morissette.
She ought to know.
Or you ought to know.
Hey, we'll come back with your text messages on the A&B text line, your phone calls, and some thoughts on Alabama. I don't know why I said that. We'll be back.
I'm Chelsea Reber with your community calendar on The Zone. The Texas A&M School of Education and Human Development welcomes you to its annual Voices of Impact speaker series. Thursday, February 23rd at the Ice House on Main. Doors open at 5, presentations begin at 6. Join Brazos Valley Community Connection for a one-day event with various community resources and agencies for those in need of services and or help. Friday, February 24th from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. at First Baptist Church in Bryan. For more information, email kduncan@sarkbv.org. The Brazos Valley African American Museum invites you to their 22nd annual appreciation event on Saturday, February 25th. Purchase your tickets online at bvaam.org. Your home for Aggie baseball is 1150 AM and 93.7 FM. Your home for Aggie softball is Gospel 97.3 FM. You can hear both online at RadioAggieland.com. That's your community calendar. I'm Chelsea Reber on The Zone.
NVR Texas Construction is taking this time out saluting our first responders during this trying year. We want to thank them all for their dedication, devotion, and courage. This message is from Rick at MVR Texas Construction right here in College Station, specializing in junk removal, dump trailers, and trailer rentals. Call 979-229-2683. That's 979-229-2683. MVR Texas Construction, thanking our first responders and frontline workers.
If you own construction equipment, you need preventative maintenance, and WPI has you covered with their new on-site service tech. Regardless of your machine's maker model, WPI has the hoses, filters, and fluids and parts needed to keep your equipment running at maximum performance. For the best price in town on preventative maintenance on every brand of construction equipment, call Jesse James at WPI in Bryan, Highway 21 East at Marino Road. Click WPI.com.
My dad has a cold, but also has high blood pressure. That's why I got him Vicks DayQuil High Blood Pressure for max strength daytime relief. Unlike some ordinary cold medicines, it's specially formulated for people like my dad. DayQuil High Blood Pressure is sugar-free, alcohol-free, and decongestant-free.
Vicks DayQuil High Blood Pressure. The daytime non-drowsy, coughing, aching, fever, sore throat, cold, and flu for people with high blood pressure.
Like my dad.
Medicine. Use as directed.
You can hear the Paul Feinbaum Show weekdays 2 to 4 here on The Zone. Presented by Polaris Fun Center. Paul Feinbaum is SEC Country. And Aggieland is SEC Country too. Join Paul weekdays 2 to 4 here on The Zone. Polaris Fun Center, where you can get a $500 rebate on any 450 or 570 Model ATV. Or $2,000 cash back on a Polaris XP1000. Polaris Fun Center, where they sell and service fun, not tractors. He's the voice of the SEC. And you can hear Paul Feinbaum weekdays from 2 to 4 on The Zone.
Hey,
I remember back in the day, OB, you were jamming this in a Toyota Corolla just down Texas Avenue, just windows open, OB and Alanis.
Yeah, never happened. No? Never happened. Even though, you know, like I said, I've heard some of her music.
It's like rain on your wedding day.
Yeah, maybe.
Is that ironic?
I guess. But, you know what? She's the kind of music where I personally would not make an effort to listen to it. But if I'm driving and it comes on the radio, I won't turn the station.
What about Harry Styles?
I'll turn the station.
You know, he won Album of the Year yesterday.
What is that? It's the Grammys. Who cares?
OB doesn't care.
Did you watch the Grammys last night?
I didn't. Besides, I was somewhat keeping besides, up with some stuff.
You mentioned
stuff,
Alanis Morrison and then Harry Styles. And for both those, I prefer male performers.
Wow.
Well, I like my rockers.
Wow.
Well, I am not. I did watch the Grammys last night, and I'm keeping my man card. My daughters are definitely into Candy 95 music. That's what they like. And I was rooting for my Boricua friend, Bad Bunny, who ended up winning Album of the Year, Latin Album of the Year. He did not win the Album of the Year, but he opened up the Grammys.
Does Bad Bunny win Latin Album of the Year every year?
No, I don't think he does. I think it's his first Grammy.
Really?
Yeah, I think so. But there was a performance by 100-year-old rappers. I don't know if you saw it on social media, but like, it was the 50-year reunion of or 50-year anniversary of hip hop, and LL Cool J performed, and like Run DMC, and like you name it, and they looked like they hadn't performed in a while. Some of them looked like it's been 20 years since they last performed. Hmm. Some of it was great. Dr. Dre got an award.
Hmm.
Your kind of stuff.
Yeah. I hate that I missed it.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I did DVR it. If you want to come over to the house later, we can watch it.
So you've been here a year and a half.
Yeah.
And it took the Grammys for you to invite me over to your home.
Yeah, pretty much.
It was never for the pool.
I hear a little judging going on there. Well, you know, I was still waiting for the cookies that you usually bring in somebody who moved to the neighborhood, and you guys didn't bring me that. So I was just kind of waiting on that awkward exchange.
And why would I would think bringing you cookies, you would think that as an insult.
It is an insult.
Because, hey, what, you want me to take in some calories? Be off with you.
OB, something tells me I have more calories than you. So that's something tells me. It is TexAgs Radio. We are presented by David Gardner's Jewelers. We are here in the Rollo Insurance Studio. It's the go hour. I know we're random. Presented by the warehouse here at CC Creations. And the text message thread there on AMB text line is popping. All right, OB. So I believe they're all official, or at least half of it is official. Kevin Steele is going to be the defensive coordinator at Alabama.
Yeah.
Right? And Tommy Reese, offensive coordinator, formerly at Notre Dame. The reception I'm seeing from most people out there is that, okay, not like a splash hire either side, but they're Alabama, they'll be fine.
Yeah. I'm not so sure if I'm not a little bit more impressed with Reese than I am Steele. I keep hearing how great Steele is. Everywhere he goes, he's great, great, great.
Yeah.
And they're always okay.
Sure.
So, and he's going to have Alabama talent to work with. So, you know, maybe he will be great. Reese is a guy that I think Notre Dame has moved the ball with some guys that I'm like, are those guys really that good?
Right.
Especially the quarterbacks. But I'll also say this, you know, at Notre Dame, they're playing half their games against ACC teams. And then they throw in Navy. And then there's always somebody like Cal, you know, and then they'll play USC here. But I have
USC's
to wonder.
USC's defense?
But I have to wonder. Yeah. Yeah. I have to wonder, is that a product of I have good talent against inferior teams, in many cases, much inferior teams.
Right.
Or am I really doing a great job? And I don't know.
Well, something tells me, no matter what, you get an upgrade from Bill O'Brien to Tommy Reese. Something tells me.
Oh, yeah. I'll tell you that.
Yeah.
How about common sense?
And Pete Golding, they couldn't wait to get rid of him either. And we'll see. He goes to Ole Miss, so we'll see how that plays out.
Yeah. I understand why they were upset at Pete Golding. I wonder if he was really the problem or just the scapegoat.
Yeah.
So I guess we'll find out.
Yeah. And maybe we'll find out. What if the Patriots have an amazing year with that offense coordinator that is Bill O'Brien?
Where was Steele last year? Miami?
Miami.
Yeah, that was a great defense.
No, they weren't good. They weren't good at all, Hobie.
And yet A&M could only score 17 points.
Do I remember correctly, like Max Johnson, like he didn't light them up, but
they scored like 17.
But he moved the ball on them after not moving the ball against anybody for a couple weeks. So
yeah. I would think that last year holding A&M to 17 points is not necessarily an endorsement of how strong your defense was.
No. What did they average, 22 a game?
Something like that.
Yeah. And it got better as the year went on. Obi, thank you, sir.
You bet.
When we come back on TexAgs Radio, Chris Gordy, he was at Senior Bowl last week. We'll talk to him about that. We got some Aggie rugby players, and Obi gave me a question to ask him.
Rugby players always have the best parties.
So can we have a TexAgs night out with the rugby players and, like, video that?
I don't
that?
Think you can handle it if it's...
Oh, I can't, no. No, I'd, at 9 o'clock, I'd be like, all right, guys,
Kay Nagley probably could.
Lucci could. All right, we'll have more next on TexAgs Radio.
Gotta be connected with The Zone. Follow us on Twitter or Instagram at The Zone 1150. Like us on Facebook at The Zone 1150. Programming alerts, prize updates, scores from games all across Bryan Broadcasting, contest news, and more. Connect with us and always be in the know.
Be in the know.
Can't remember what team is playing on what station? When are they giving away what? And when is the coach on the show? Follow us on Twitter or Instagram at Zone 1150. And be sure to like us on Facebook at Zone 1150. And always be in the know.
Protect your computers, tablets, and smartphones from hackers by looking for secure internet addresses that begin with HTTPS. It is an indication they are protected by a secure encrypted connection. Only encrypted websites can help secure your internet communications and act as your first line of defense against hackers. A public service message from the Consumer Electronics Association.
You can listen to your favorite shows, Louie, Chip, TexAgs, or Paul Feinbaum, online at RadioAggieland.com or Zone1150.com. This is KZNE College Station Bryan, Aggieland's home for sports. For sports.
WTAW, I'm Chelsea Reber with a news update on The Zone. A person was struck by a train in the Northgate District yesterday around 3:30 in the morning. A Union Pacific spokesman says the person is hospitalized in Temple with life-threatening injuries. No one on the train was hurt. College Station police reported a 22-year-old man was struck near Welburn and Church. Huntsville police arrest two men following weekend gunfire where two men died and two others are hospitalized in critical condition. Officers responded Saturday during the midnight hour to a large house party a block south of Sam Houston State Soccer Stadium. A pair of 18-year-olds were killed, James Jones of Huntsville and Cruz Garcia of Livingston. Two men from Livingston were arrested, one for aggravated assault with a deadly weapon and the other for misdemeanor assault. College Station police report on social media Saturday morning being involved in a pursuit of the person driving a stolen vehicle. A male juvenile whose age was not released was caught following a brief foot chase. He was taken to juvenile detention following his arrest for unauthorized use of a motor vehicle and evading arrest twice. CSPD did not release whether the vehicle was unlocked and or the engine was running when it was stolen from the Woodlands Apartments. This is the last month eligible households can receive emergency SNAP benefits that were implemented during the pandemic. Shannon Avila, programs director at the Brazos Valley Food Bank, discussed how this will impact the food bank and its partners.
Combined with food supply constraints and inflation and the overall need in the Brazos Valley, we expect that this reduction in SNAP benefits, that means less resources for the individual household, which means that they will likely visit food pantries more.
Health Promotions Manager Mariah Suora reminds people who are losing the emergency benefits to check what other benefits they might be eligible for by going online to yourtexasbenefits.com. For more news, go online to WTAW.com. I'm Chelsea Reber on The Zone.
VeraBank is open and we are excited to serve you in College Station. Hi, this is Erica Archer, Treasury Management Officer at VeraBank, and I specialize in helping businesses run their day-to-day operations more efficiently, saving you valuable time. Our team's job is to make yours easier. So give us a call or come by and see us off of Highway 6. At VeraBank, you have a team of genuine bankers on your side, and you can bank on it.
Visit VeraBank.com today. That's VeraBank.com. VeraBank. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
We're here with Jackson Rollo from Rollo Insurance. And Jackson, you guys have been around for a long time. You're the very best at what you do. But I ask you, why Rollo Insurance?
Well, we've been growing recently with over 45 offices in multiple states. But we haven't lost who we are. We're still super focused on being hyper-local and involved in the communities in which you're going to find a Rollo Insurance office. And we offer products like home, auto, life, health, and business insurance from some of the top carriers in our industry.
You name it, they do it. Visit RolloInsurance.com.
Good morning, sports fans. I'm Sean Burnett with your Aggie Sports Minute on the Zone. This update is brought to you by Hilco Metal Roofing and Supply. Call 936-825-0500 or click HilcoSupply.com. Texas A&M men's basketball got a big win at home against Georgia Saturday night. After the game, Coach Buzz Williams said he was impressed with the way his team responded after the loss to Arkansas.
I thought we were even better than normal, and one day before yesterday, thought we had great energy at shoot around today. And so it's been 13 days since we've played a game, and the game was our actual fourth rep. And I thought that that was visible in how we played on both ends of the floor tonight. I thought there was great connectivity, cohesiveness, symmetry, whatever words you want to use in those adjectives. Not just offensively, but defensively.
The guys will get their second run at Auburn Tuesday night with a 6 o'clock tip, and you can hear that game on 1620-94.5 WTAW. Aggie women's basketball took number 3 LSU to the brink, but couldn't quite get it done in a 72-66 loss Sunday. Head coach Joni Taylor after the game on the process moving forward.
Every single day, are we better today than we were yesterday? And if we continue to do that, will the outcome be this year what we want? No. But our players understand that they're laying the foundation for years to come, and that's what our focus is.
And that's your Aggie Sports Minute, brought to you by Hilco Metal Roofing and Supply. On The Zone, I'm Sean Burnett.
Start your sports day with Keyshawn, J. Will, and Max, powered by WC Tractor. Weekday mornings from 5 to 8 on 1150 AM and 93.7 FM. Or just tell your smart speaker to play Zone 1150. WC Tractor is your local award-winning Kubota and New Holland dealer. Call them with your questions at 1-888-8-TRACTOR. That's 1-888-8-TRACTOR. Or check them out online at WCTractor.com. Rise and shine. Weekday mornings from 5 to 8 with Keyshawn, J. Will, and Max from ESPN Radio. Powered by WC Tractor here on The Zone.
Yeah, this album is dedicated to all the teachers that told me I never amount to nothing. To all the people that lived above the buildings that I was hustling from that called the police on me when I was just trying to make some money to feed my daughter.
Yeah.
And to all my peoples in the struggle, you know what I'm saying? It's all good, baby.
Check.
It was all a dream. I used to read Word Up magazine.
Little Biggie Smalls. Christopher Wallace, TexAgs Radio, presented by David Gardner's Jewelers here in the Rollo Insurance Studio. So we had Senior Bowl, we've got Pro Bowl. I didn't watch a second of anything Pro Bowl related. I know people were tweeting about it. We have Super Bowl coming up, Texans hire a coach. We've got offensive coordinators all over the, or actually coordinators in general in the SEC. A lot of topics to talk about football related with our friend Chris Gordy on the hotline there from the Locked On SEC and iHeartRadio. Chris, good morning, sir.
Good morning, David. I'm with you. I didn't watch any of that Pro Bowl crap. Do it over. Find something else.
Well, I didn't like the Pro Bowl when it was just the football game. So am I understanding this correctly? They went from a real Pro Bowl to now a flag football game. Is that right?
Well, it was basically becoming two-hand touch anyway. Nobody wanted to tackle anybody. Nobody wanted to get hurt. So this is the evolution of it. But, man, they got to figure out something else. All the all-star games for all the sports just kind of – they're all disappointing nowadays.
Yeah, they are. Like, there was a time like the NBA All-Star weekend was still like, I would get so excited about it. I'm not even there anymore. I still kind of keep tabs on it. Major League Baseball All-Star game's got some charm to it still, but it's not what it was. Maybe because I'm old, but it's not what it was when I was young.
No, I'm with you there. It's I tell people all the time, like I'd rather watch A&M spring game on a loop than watch like the Pro Bowl or MLB All-Star game or something like that.
No doubt about that. Hey, let's talk Senior Bowl. How was the experience? I know you got to talk to a lot of players. You got to see a lot of action, practices, and whatnot. How was that whole experience?
Yeah, it was cool. It's always a fun experience to see all these guys. I mean, it was crazy this year how they formatted it. Like, basically almost all the guys from the SEC were on the American team. So it was, like, kind of hard to get as many interviews as I'd like because they were all on the same team. Normally they kind of break it up, and there's some guys on this team, some guys on that. But, you know, probably the best interview I had all week was with a guy who didn't even play, and that was Hendon Hooker from Tennessee. Really impressive young man. I've interviewed him a handful of times, and he's, you know, still recovering from the knee injury, and he's not doing anything physically, but he was just there to do interviews and meet with teams, and hard not to be impressed with him. He says he's going to be ready to go for the start of training camp, so I don't know where he slots now. I've been hearing that the Saints, with the 29th pick that they got from the Sean Payton trade, that maybe that could be a landing spot for him. So just very interesting with all the talk of Bryce Young and Will Levis, C.J. Stroud, Anthony Richardson. Hendon Hooker might be that guy that sneaks into the back end of the first and maybe goes to a better spot than some of those other guys go to.
Do you think it may scare some teams away, though, because of his age? What is he, 25, 26 years old?
Yeah, there's a little bit of that. I think, you know, talking with a couple people this week, they said that so there's a little bit more immediacy for him to play. You know what I mean? Like, in a perfect world, he sits and learns for a year. Well, that clock's already ticking. So it's like he needs to go somewhere where he can play almost immediately. But I've been told there's no concerns with the knee injury. He should be ready to go. And I'm excited to see where he goes. He was a tremendous athlete, and I thought he got robbed of, and he should have at least gotten an invite to the Heisman. I know the injury hurt him in that realm, but again, he was very impressive. And then on the field, you know, I think there were some of those pass rushers and offensive linemen from the SEC that really impressed. You know, there was an offensive lineman from Tennessee, Darnell Wright, who looked really good. I'm told he improved his stock. He could go back into the first. Byron Young from Tennessee looked really good. DJ Dale from Alabama, you know, is a name we know very well, you know, throughout the years in the SEC. I was told by one scout coming into Senior Bowl week, he had him as like a middle rounder. He said he pushed him up to like, you know, second rounder now because of what he saw Senior Bowl week. So it's just so interesting how guys can really improve their stock. I don't know anybody who's hurt their stock going to the Senior Bowl. And hey, send a message to Stetson Bennett. You made a dumb mistake, and he should have been there this past week because he would have definitely impressed with the subpar quarterback play we had at the Senior Bowl.
All right, let's do February 6th kind of perspective of the SEC. There's like a bunch of new offensive coordinators, a bunch of new defensive coordinators, and what is it, 9 new quarterbacks potentially next year, maybe 10? Like, there's a lot of changes that are out there for the SEC. How do you kind of look at it in the first part of February and see how that'll shake out from the competitiveness of these teams that we're used to seeing at an elite level?
Well, it's interesting. I mean, I think a lot of the teams that are considered, you know, kind of like the in-betweeners, like, you know, we think they're good, but not maybe on Alabama and Georgia's level, are the teams that have the hardest part figured out. They know who their quarterback is. A&M, you assume it's going to be Connor Wegman. LSU brings back Jaden Daniels. Arkansas brings back KJ Jefferson. Will Rogers is back at Mississippi State. Like, a lot of these teams have it all figured out. Alabama and Georgia are the two teams that don't know who their quarterback is. It's an open quarterback battle. They both lose Stetson Bennett and Bryce Young. So that's going to be the big highlight of the spring. Of course, Alabama replaces both coordinators. Going to be very interesting to see how they both settle in. Tommy Reese coming from Notre Dame and bringing back Kevin Steele for like his 8th tour of duty in the SEC. I thought it was kind of underwhelming hires for Alabama. We'll see how it plays out. You got a bunch of 4- and 5-star talent. Maybe David, you and I could go in there and coach Alabama and win some games. But that's going to be really interesting to see how the quarterback battles shape up. Jalen Milroe versus Ty Simpson at Alabama. And then, you know, it's kind of Carson Beck versus Brock Vandergrift at Georgia. All very talented quarterbacks, all very highly rated, highly touted and all that. But I think there is an advantage with these other schools like A&M, like LSU, to say, we've got the hardest part figured out. We know who our quarterback is. We're just trying to figure out everything else.
We're talking to Chris Gordy here on TexAgs Radio, presented by David Gardner's Jewelers here in the Rollo Insurance Studio. What about the things that's going on with the Big 12, right? So you got Texas and Oklahoma that potentially, or not potentially, it looks like they're going to have to stay a couple more years. They were trying to find their way out early, early, early. Keeps being pushed back. Now it looks like they're going to be there at least through 20, well, not at least, until 2025.
Yeah, it's so funny how this works out, right? Like, the announcement comes out a couple years ago at SEC Media Days. I think it was the Houston Chronicle broke it, and they said 2025, Texas and Oklahoma are coming to the SEC. And I think everybody heard that was like, oh, okay, but they're going to find a way to get the buyout done early, and this is going to happen sooner rather than later. And the more we've gone along with this, David, we found out greed. It's about money. It's about greed. ESPN and Fox and all these big TV networks, they don't want to give up, you know, big games that could bring big ratings and bring big money to their networks. And the unfortunate part about it is the teams that are kind of getting messed over here are the four new teams that came to the Big 12, BYU, Houston, UCF. They all come over, Cincinnati. They come over with the idea that, hey, we're going to the Big 12. We're going to have a chance to improve ourselves. Oh, wait, Oklahoma and Texas are still going to hang around another year? Okay, that's fine. We'll play them once. Wait, now we're finding out they're going to be in there for two more years? Like, that's what kind of stinks about it. Is like, if you're Dana Holgerson at Houston, you're like, please just like get them out. I don't want, and not to say they can't beat Oklahoma or Texas. It just makes the schedule that much more difficult having to play two big blue bloods like that. So, look, the SEC's fine. I talked to Greg Sankey last summer about it. He's like, well, if we got to wait till 2025, we'll wait till 2025. It is what it is. But for the Big 12, I know they would love to get them out because, David, this is like, announcing you're getting divorced from your wife and then her living with you for two more years. It's just awkward for everybody. Like, no, move out. The paperwork has already been done. Let's move on with our lives.
We're talking to Chris Gordy here on TexAgs Radio. Chris, let's talk about Bryce Young and the kind of quarterback that he can be at the next level. I know one of the big things, the big dings, is his size, but the dude is a winner. Do you see a situation where the Texans do end up getting him, knowing that Chicago is in the business to maybe trade that first pick?
It's going to be interesting. I mean, if I was the Houston Texans, Bryce Young would be my pick, number two overall. I think he's been the best quarterback in the last couple of years in the SEC. I think, I talked to a friend of mine who's real close to the Alabama program. He said he is by far and away their best quarterback that they've ever had, that he's better than Tua. He's better than all these guys they've had in recent years. And granted, he won the Heisman 2 years ago, but I think what was more impressive this year is what he did without a loaded deck. For the first time in the Nick Saban era, we saw an offensive line that wasn't very good. For the first time in the Nick Saban era, they didn't have a go-to wide receiver. Who was their number one this year? They didn't have one. So to me, that was even more impressive with how productive Bryce Young was this year. I just, if I'm the Texans, winning that week 18 game or whatever was so stupid. Going for two and, you know, beating Indianapolis Colts, it was so, you know, like, why? You had the number one pick in your hands for all those weeks. You win that meaningless game. You now fall behind the Chicago Bears, who have the number one pick. And the Bears hold all the cards. I think they really do like Will Anderson. I think they do really like Jalen Carter. And they could feel fine with moving back to four with the Colts, and they get one of those guys there. So it'll be interesting to see how this plays out. I have no concerns with Bryce Young's height. I talked with Chris Doering in the SEC Network this past week at the Senior Bowl. He said Bryce Young is still number one in his eyes. He brought up the fact, and I thought this was an amazing stat. Bryce Young never left the field at the end of a game this year without having the lead. Like, every time he left the game, there are two losses against LSU and Tennessee. They lost because the defense gave it up. It had nothing to do with what he did. So I thought that was pretty outstanding. And again, I love Bryce Young. He's number one in my books. I wouldn't be sad if the Texans got C.J. Stroud, but I think all the Will Levis hype is way too overhyped. I would not be looking at Will Levis as a top five pick.
Oh, no, absolutely. I 1,000% agree with you. And all that being said, there's a reason that Alabama allowed Pete Golding to go to Ole Miss. That defense was a problem. Couple of new coordinators there, so that we are seeing changes. LSU's got Daniels coming back, so their quarterback position is pretty shaped up. But how do you see that the SEC West, considering A&M is bringing in Bobby Petrino, LSU is pretty stable, and there are question marks there at Alabama?
Yeah, it's going to be very interesting. I mean, I think LSU, Jaden Daniels is only going to get better in that Mike Denbrock offense, so that'll be intriguing to see. One of my favorite storylines is to see with Bobby Petrino, you know, how does this work with Connor Wegman? Does the offense open up even more? Does he get more comfortable in the system? All that kind of stuff. I think that's such an awesome, fun story to watch. The Alabama and Georgia battles, like we said earlier, are going to be interesting to watch. But another storyline, David, Will Rogers has been a stud. He's been one of the, you know, leading the SEC in passing yards the last couple of years. What does he look like without Mike Leach now? And again, it's one of the most unfortunate storylines of the offseason. And, you know, rest in peace to Mike Leach. But what does that offense look like now with Will Rogers? And I've been told by a couple people, Mississippi State's going to be more defensive-minded now. Zach Arnett is a bright defensive mind. And can we imagine, David, Mississippi State going for winning games like 34-29 to now they're playing, you know, 17-10 type games where the offense kind of bogs down, but the defense gets it done. So some amazing storylines going on around the SEC, but man, it's hard not to put Will Rogers right there at the top because he's been among the league leaders in passing since he's been in the SEC.
Let's talk about the two NFL teams in the state of Texas and just kind of the vibe around them. The Texans have done nothing right for 5-6 years. And it looks like, at least from a PR perspective, the fans are all in with D'Amico. Then you got the Cowboys, who are obviously way further along in their, how close that they are to doing something big. Mike McCarthy's still going to be the guy there. And, you know, fans wondering how that will play out over one more year of Mike McCarthy and wasting another year of Dak and potentially some of the other guys. So just talk about the feelings around both franchises.
Yeah, it's interesting, the Cowboys bringing in Brian Schottenheimer, who Georgia fans remember not glowingly. Their offense was god-awful in 2015 when he was running when he was their OC. But, you know, big question mark for Dallas, and a lot of people think that, you know, with their defense coordinator sticking around another year, that he's kind of going to be the de facto head coach whenever they decide to move on from Mike McCarthy and Dan Quinn. So, it's hard to not feel like Mike McCarthy isn't dead man walking there. But with the Texans, man, everybody I talked to at the Senior Bowl last week when the news broke on D'Amico Ryans, everybody was saying home run hire. I mean, it just makes sense. The guy was the most qualified candidate out there. He checks all the boxes. He's earned it and the legacy of him having played for the Texans before. I think the Texans are going to turn this thing around very quickly. And you look around at the league at some of these teams where they drafted a quarterback top five, and by year two, they were in the postseason. Look at Joe Burrow with Cincinnati. Look at Trevor Lawrence in Jacksonville. By year two, they made that big leap and got in the playoffs. Would not surprise me if the Texans go down that same route with whoever they take number two.
5 years from today, who's got more playoff wins? And I'm not comparing it to the Cowboys. The Browns, who have Deshaun Watson, they got their quarterback. Or the Texans, 5 years from today, in that span, who's got more playoff wins?
Man, it's easy to just say the Browns because Deshaun is, we expect he'll bounce back and all that next year. But that division is tough. Texans playing a crappy division. So they got a real chance to turn this thing around very quickly. It's not going to happen this year, but by year two, year three of D'Amico Ryans, I do think they can. So if I was putting money on it, I would probably go with the Texans just because the division they play in. And man, Deshaun looks so bad this year. I have to wonder, was that just rust, or is this who he is now, where he's lost a step and the league has caught up to him?
Yeah, well, his Instagram account hasn't lost a step, apparently. So, Chris, great stuff as always, my friend. Thanks very much, and we'll talk to you soon, all right?
Thanks, David. Anytime, man.
All right, man. When we come back here on TexAgs Radio, a little Aggie rugby. I don't know why I want to say Aggie. Aggie rugby. Can you say it for me, Kay?
I'm away from the mic right now.
Sorry.
Sorry, I was over here just for a second.
One day, we're going to redesign the studio. I don't know when that day is coming.
Uh-huh.
Where I'm going to actually be able to see you.
See you and yeah. See that I was dialed in over here.
So those of you who don't know the makeout here, or the layout, I should say. The layout of the studio. She's behind like a wall, so I can't see her here. But it looks like on TV that like she's like, you know, we're making eye contact.
Yep.
Disregard, I forgot what we're talking about. But I'm in the mood for Fargo's. They're not open today. I can still be in the mood for it. I can still want to eat Fargo's. I mean, who doesn't want to eat at Fargo's? It's open Tuesday through Saturday, 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. Closed on Sundays and closed on Mondays. That same phone number you know, 979-778-3662. If you haven't been to that Fargo's Pit Barbecue at their new location on 1701 South Texas Avenue, you're missing out. One of the top 50 barbecue joints in the world. Not in the state. Not in the country, in the world. Thank you to Texas Monthly. They go around the world. They know. They're open Tuesday through Saturday, and they got amazing specials. They love doing it. No mass production there. They have a very secret sauce and a very secret food. When you taste it, you're like, wow, can I know how to do this? No, you just got to go there. You got to go there on Tuesdays through Saturdays. Rib tips only offered on Tuesdays and Saturdays. Once they're gone, they are gone. Wednesdays, you got the chopped beef on a baked potato. You name it, they got it. They've been around for about 22 years. And they'll take care of you for weddings, anniversaries, any family gathering out there. Fargo, 1701 South Texas Avenue in Bryan. Without a doubt, the best barbecue in town. That's their trademark because it's true. It's Fargo's.
I'm Chelsea Reber with your community calendar on The Zone. Silver Taps will be held Tuesday night in honor of three Aggies who died recently. The ceremony begins at 10:30 p.m. in the Academic Plaza. Registration is now open for Harvey Little League. Register your kid or be a Harvey sponsor by going online to BrianHarveyLittleLeague.com. The deadline is February 16th.
Hardcore Dynamics, a Texas A&M co-ed a cappella group, presents Acapalooza at Rudder Auditorium on Saturday, February 18th at 6 p.m. Find the event with a ticket link on WTAW's community calendar at WTAW.com. Stage Center Theater in downtown Bryan presents Sleuth. Performances run February 9th through the 25th. Purchase your tickets online at stagecenter.net. Listen to the NFL playoffs on 1150 AM and 93.7 FM, thanks to Hungry Howie's. You can hear the divisional round, championship weekend, and the Super Bowl every game on The Zone. That's your community calendar. I'm Chelsea Reber on The Zone.
NVR Texas Construction is taking this time out saluting our first responders during this trying year. We want to thank them all for their dedication, devotion, and courage. This message is from Rick at MVR Texas Construction right here in College Station, specializing in junk removal, dump trailers, and trailer rentals. Call 979-229-2683. That's 979-229-2683. MVR Texas Construction, thanking our first responders and frontline workers.
If you own construction equipment, you need preventative maintenance, and WPI has you covered with their new on-site service tech. Regardless of your machine's make or model, WPI has the hoses, filters, and fluids and parts needed to keep your equipment running at maximum performance. For the best price in town on preventative maintenance on every brand of construction equipment, call Jesse James at WPI in Bryan. Highway 21 East at Marino Road. Click WPI.com.
Finding great candidates to hire can be like, well, trying to find a needle in a haystack, but not with ZipRecruiter. Its powerful technology actively finds and invites qualified candidates to apply to your job. So while other companies might deliver a lot of hay, ZipRecruiter finds you the needle in the haystack.
See why 4 out of 5 employers who post a job on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate within the first day. Try ZipRecruiter for free at ZipRecruiter.com/free. That's ZipRecruiter.com/free.
You can listen to Aggie football, basketball, and baseball on your Amazon Dot or Echo. Step one, say Alexa, enable Zone 1150 skill. Step two, anytime you want to hear Fighting Texas Aggie football, Texas A&M women's basketball, or Aggie baseball, all you have to do is say, Alexa, play Zone 1150. It's that simple to listen to your favorite A&M teams that play on the Zone with your Amazon Dot or Echo. Make sure to say one time, Alexa, enable Zone 1150 skill. Then say, Alexa, play Zone 1150.
All right, we're back. TexAgs Radio, presented by David Gardner's Jewelers here in the Rollo Insurance Studio. All right, so we got some rugby to talk about. Usually James Lowry joins us here, but we've got a bunch of his players here who just we talk about the Aggie basketball team dominating Georgia. What you guys did to Texas Tech this weekend is illegal, right? So what was it, 141-0, and I'm thinking, oh, these, you know, each point's got to be worth like 20, right? Like, no, you said they're like football points, right?
Yep, yeah. Close enough.
How the heck did that happen? Like, how do you beat a team? Like, have you ever, like, what's the worst blowout you've been a part of in rugby before?
I think for me, like, 50 to, like, 10.
50 to 10?
Probably somewhere in
there. Okay, that sounds like a football blowout. Yeah. Okay.
I was just about to say, the game before this, we played Oklahoma, and we beat them 69-7, 67-7.
67-7, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
My biggest blowout was here, actually. Freshman year, 92-10 against TU.
92-10, wow. Yeah. All right, so let me give, announcements. We've got Manu right here, Zapata.
Yep.
All right, Argentinian, yep. Celebrating the World Cup. All right, we've got Cameron. Is it Cuella?
Shula.
Oh, like yeah, Don Shula.
Yeah.
But spelled completely different.
Yeah, big throws everyone off.
Yeah, and then Caden, how do you pronounce your last name?
Vonout.
All right, guys, so you had a blowout last week, and your home opener is this weekend. Who are you guys playing?
UNT.
UNT.
Yeah.
Aren't they usually good, or am I making this up?
Half of the years.
Yeah.
Usually COVID hit everyone, so everyone's rebuilding but us, realistically.
Yeah, which is good to hear.
Yeah.
So how did the fall go? Because I know it's through different seasons, correct?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So Caden, you take it.
Well, we had... Personally, I played for the Sevens team this fall, and so we had, like, 3 different tournaments, and we won every game in those tournaments, and now, because we won those games, we have a chance to go to Nationals this May.
Yep.
And I know our gray side was able to play a couple 15s games, And so they played really well in the fall, and now they're getting to play again in the spring. And then we played Air Force this fall, who's ranked like right around where we are at home. Unfortunately, we lost to them, but it was a close game. I think we should have won.
Okay. And then, Cameron, I'll ask you, how does this year's team compare to what we've seen in the last couple of years? Because you told me, you guys said that this team is kind of like the same, right? Like, so how much more mentally prepared and physically prepared are you for this year compared to last season?
I think we've definitely gotten a step up in, like, mental preparedness for games. We've had a lot better leadership. We've taken a lot leadership steps, and we've been able to get ready for games a lot better, because I think we always struggled with, like, kind of focusing up on games and losing, like with Tech, like, we'd not take a team seriously,
right,
and kind of lose focus. And then this year we've been a lot more, you know, locked in and ready to go on games and do stuff like last weekend.
Mano, how does a guy from Argentina, get into rugby? How did that whole thing happen?
So I started playing when I was five. Okay. My older brother, I have an older brother, a younger brother, you know, older brother rivalry. So he started playing, I started playing, played my whole life. So I'm in my 17th year playing rugby. And coming here was a smart decision. I talked to Coach James when I was a freshman, and he was like, yeah, come on over, come and play.
You moved from Argentina to the Woodlands, is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
And then I lived in Spain for a while as well, moved back, and then graduated in the Woodlands and came here and never looked back.
So I look at Coach Lowry, James Lowry, as like one of the nicest human beings in the world. Always got a smile on his face, but he looks like somebody you don't mess with, right? Like he's a big, strong dude, like that can bring it. Have you guys seen the mean side of him?
Oh yeah.
Yes.
A lot. Oh yeah.
Okay. The best way to describe it is, he's someone you mess with until you don't want to.
Okay.
You can definitely mess with him, like if it's just playful fun, but when he's serious, you've got to be serious. Otherwise, you're in for a rough time.
What about on the sidelines? Has he ever, like, you know, other side kind of say
something? Especially during the games is when you want to be careful with what's happening, because he will chew you out when you're on the field.
Yeah.
I've had my fair. So, like, whenever we return a kick, I'm always the guy like stands closest to the sideline. And I always get an earful about my last bad play and to knock it off.
How often do you guys practice?
Three times a week.
Three times a week, okay. And then you all need help, right? Because the funds, you guys have to pay a little bit to play, and you need funds from people. So how can people help out?
I mean, we can accept donations. There's a
merchandise site. Yeah, we got our merchandise up on our the Flywire website.
Okay. And you guys do car washes too and stuff. Am I right, or am I making that up? You're making
that up.
Okay.
We should.
We could just. Well, we're gonna do
it. We should.
Let's do a car wash. All right. And tell me a little. So Olin on the show in the first hour, you guys don't know who he is, but he said he has heard that the Aggie rugby players have the best parties. Is this true? You guys are legendary party guys. You're worried about how to answer.
Yeah, I'm really worried how to answer that. We have great events when we get together. Let me put it that way.
Okay.
They're very fun.
Do they start at like a normal time, like an old man with kids can go, or like we're talking about 6 p.m. or are we talking about 1 a.m. start?
We're talking like 9, 10 p.m. starting, because usually, you know, we have a game, so we got to get back into town, eat food, shower, you know, we don't want to smell.
Right.
And then, you know, we get together, have a lot of fun until the long hours of the night. And
means the party goes on until when?
You know, 3-4 in the morning.
Okay, yeah. There was a time. All right, so for those of you who want to go this weekend, where do we go? Is it Penberthy again?
Yep.
Yeah, Penberthy.
Yes. Oh, and what time are the games?
1 p.m.
1 p.m., UNT.
Yep.
And you guys are favored to win it all?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And how does it work out? So you win your league, then there's a national showcase as well?
Right, so we win a conference, and then we're expected to win it, and after we win it, we'll go to South California. More than likely to play one of those teams for the first round of playoffs.
Okay. All right, John. Well, thank you so much for coming in. Sorry it was an early wake up, because I'm sure you were out till 4 a.m. last night. Thanks very much. All right, go check out the Aggie rugby team taking on UNT this weekend at Penberthy. 1 o'clock start for that. Go early and enjoy it. Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, when we come back around Aggieland next on TexAgs.
It's the one chill in the world, the Texagi football,
Star Wars,
and progressive overload of the gym.
It's TexAgs Radio with Dave, Ole, and Billy here on the Zone.
Shop local, buy local, save big deals.
Hi, it's Jenny from your local big deal store. If you've never visited our website, you're missing out because we've partnered with some of the best local businesses in town. Dozens of gift certificates, all discounted, ready for you to buy today. Here are just a few of the businesses you'll find.
Elements Massage of Bryan College Station, C&J Barbecue, You Paint It, and Texas Burger. Shop and save now at AggielandBigDeals.com.
You can hear the Paul Feinbaum Show weekdays 2 to 4 here on The Zone. Presented by Polaris Fun Center. Paul Feinbaum is SEC Country. And Aggieland is SEC Country too. Join Paul weekdays 2 to 4 here on The Zone. Polaris Fun Center, where you can get a $500 rebate on any 450 or 570 Model A TV. Or $2,000 cash back on a Polaris XP1000. Polaris Fun Center, where they sell and service fun, not tractors. The voice of the SEC. And you can hear Paul Feinbaum weekdays from 2 to 4 on The Zone.
Does your bank know your first name? At Normandy State Bank, they do. Normandy State Bank is locally owned, controlled, and operated. This local, personal touch means banking decisions are made on-site the same day you request it. Normandy State makes banking easy. They're open Saturdays, offer state-of-the-art online banking, bill paying, fund transfers, check and statement images. Normandy State, where customer service is their priority. Normandy State Bank, rock solid. Member FDIC.
If you or someone you know wants to earn $100,000 per year or more, plus annual bonuses, LSP Transport is looking for drivers with a strong work ethic to be part of their successful team. LSP Transport is seeking Class A CDL drivers with at least 2 years of experience. If you're a Class A CDL driver looking for a better opportunity or know someone that is, visit www.lspt.jobs now, as these high-paying positions are limited. LSP Transport, an equal opportunity employer.
Keyshawn Johnson, Jay Williams, and Max Kellerman.
We're joined now by Rob Ninkovich and Jeremy Fowler. If Mahomes retired today, he's a top five quarterback ever. Not ahead of Joe Montana.
I don't want to go down this track with this dude.
Orlovsky has him second. That's ridiculous.
Second?
Joe Montana.
Other
than Montana, no one's ever had 5 years like this.
The list is, it doesn't even work. I mean, I get it. Dan feels a certain way. And Patrick Mahomes, we could argue, since Mahomes has been in this league, he's obviously not better than Tom Brady, not better than Aaron Rodgers. And if you really wanted to dig deep, he's not better than Big Ben. Drew Brees as well.
If we're talking about a five-year sample size.
Thank you, Jeremy.
Of what a guy has done and how that projects in the next 10, 15, he's on a track for top three.
Listen in to Key, J. Will, and Max, powered by WC Tractor from 5 to 8 on The Zone.
We're back, TexAgs Radio, presented by David Gardner's Jewelers here in the Rollo Insurance Studio. Appreciate the Aggie rugby team coming by and that party that I'm going to go to at some point. Kay doesn't believe I'll make it through. Kay Nagley there.
I don't.
Why?
There's no way. When's the last time you stayed up past 1 p.m. or 1 a.m.?
1 p.m. every day.
1 a.m.
Last time I stayed up past 1 a.m. Let me think. Actually, I lied to you earlier.
Oh.
I stayed out past 1 a.m. the night I arrived in Miami because we didn't get to the rehearsal dinner till 10 p.m. We ate, hung out, and it was probably 1:30 before I went to bed.
You looked at the clock and you were like, oh my gosh, I have not seen this time.
Technically, was it really 1 a.m. if I was still on Texas time mentally? You know what I'm saying? Like, I didn't have so it's kind of midnight, but yeah. Not often.
Yeah.
I had one of those nights where I watched a couple of Yellowstones until midnight. Within the last six
Whoa.
Weeks. Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah. And I hated myself in the morning. Yeah.
Was it that you had to come do radio next morning?
Yeah, I had to do radio. Yeah. Look, there was a time, and it wasn't that long ago, that I would go to bed past 1 o'clock routinely when I worked in the news industry. So we're not talking about that long ago, but I didn't always have to wake up at 4:45, 4:30. So there's that.
That'll definitely damper the mood when you have to, that 5 a.m. alarm goes off. It's not fun.
Hey, it is time for Around Aggieland, which is presented by Normandy State Bank. Normandy State Bank, rock solid banking. The website is normandystatebank.com. Miss Nakely, what do we have?
We have a lot going on. Some different sports starting this week, and Aggie softball and Aggie baseball are getting ready to start. So I'm ready for those sports. But first of all, men's basketball, a trio of Aggies reached double figures as Texas A&M rolled Georgia in front of over 12,000 fans at Reed Arena on Saturday. The Maroon and White shot over 50% and a 38% behind the arc in their dismantling of the visiting Bulldogs. Auburn will head to Reed this Tuesday. So I know a lot of students personally are getting really excited about this team. So excited to see what they do and continue to do. Women's basketball. A&M was in range of upsetting the undefeated LSU Tigers at Reed Arena on Sunday, but failed to grab a hold of that lead, could not get their second conference victory. Sahara Jones had 14 points and nearly blemished LSU's perfect record with a second-half push. The Aggs will now head on the road to take on Mississippi State this Sunday. As I said earlier, some Fightin' Texas Aggies softball will return to Davis Dive-In this weekend as the Maroon and White host the Texas A&M Invitational. A lot of different teams coming into town, and I believe Richard Zinn will have some notes on that Trisha Ford squad, so be sure to look out for that. The men and women's track teams, or the 4x4 teams, registered record book times as Texas A&M track and field teams competed the final day of the New Mexico Collegiate Classic. The men and women's teams will now split up this weekend, going to the Tiger Paw Invitational in Clemson and then the David Henry Valentine Invitational in Boston. A little more going on. Equestrian, the number 4 team, took down number 3 Auburn 13-5 on Friday at the Hildebrand Equine Complex. And then one more thing, women's tennis got the dub this weekend over Rice, and men's tennis ended up falling to Ohio State on the road. So a lot going on around Aggieland. I know it's an exciting time for all of us.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Appreciate the report back. So, all right, Kay, so if I would go to bed and not make it, can you last till 3 a.m.?
Yes, yeah. I unwillingly stayed up till probably like I'm actually in a kines class right now where we have to track our sleep.
Tell me more.
I'm realizing I don't get enough, and that's especially this weekend. It was a long one for whatever reason. But I was, you know, tracking it all down. I'm like, oh. Wait,
so what kind of track? Are we talking about like through your Apple Watch, through like you're just writing it down? I'm going to bed at 10.
No, so it's not really like tracking your sleep. It's just like tracking your hours. It's just like a sleep analysis report. So it's like what time you went to bed, when you woke up, how did you feel? If you had like a heavy meal before, if you did exercise, like different things like that. So just trying to.
What are you averaging then the last few days?
I think I'm 5 hours. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah. Do you feel it during the day?
A yes and no. I'm in college, so I'm equipped to, you know, be used to this and thrive off of it. But
do you need a nap sometimes?
Yeah, I don't normally get one. No. But with here, school, trying to, you know, have to go to the gym every day. I usually don't.
That's a humble brag right there.
You know.
A little humble brag. Like, I gotta go to the gym.
I have to, David.
What are you, Jimmies?
Big gym bros in the studio right now.
Hey, we've talked about doing a kind of fitness podcast that 9 of our listeners would like.
I would be into it.
All right.
I would be into it. You, me, and Bronny, I could talk all day.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Gloves in the gym or no?
No gloves. All right. Calluses are okay.
We're done.
It's okay.
Let's talk about the Association of Former Students. They've been around for 140. There's no segue from like wearing gloves to the association, yeah, right? Man. Like the only thing I can say is they haven't been wearing gloves for 140 years. That I can guarantee you. But they have been helping people for 140 years, and they've done that with your donations, because your donations have empowered them to help out Aggies all around the globe. And that's, I'm talking about current Aggies, or current students, I should say, and former students. All those have been helped by the Association of Former Students, and that could be with the Traveling Aggies. It could be through tailgating, muster, class reunions, ring day, silver taps, Aggie bands, student assistance programs, and scholarships. So that is what the association does. They help so many different ways, and you are the reason that they do what they do. So they created a website called IamTheWhy.com. IamTheWhy.com is a website which you've heard me talk about it. You should go. Like, check out these stories. It's about Aggies, right? They're just cool little vignettes. Some are short, some are a little bit longer, but you can get a feel for what a lot of different Aggies have gone through. And if you want, you can tell your story as well. They'll take your story, upload it. Bam, technology's there for you to do that. It is IamTheWhy.com. Again, the website, IamTheWhy.com, the Association of Former Students.
I'm Chelsea Reber with your community calendar on The Zone. The Texas A&M School of Education and Human Development welcomes you to its annual Voices of Impact Speaker Series. Thursday, February 23rd at the Ice House on Main. Doors open at 5, presentations begin at 6. Join Brazos Valley Community Connection for a one-day event with various community resources and agencies for those in need of services and or help. Friday, February 24th from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. at First Baptist Church in Bryan. For more information, email kduncan@sarkbv.org. The Brazos Valley African American Museum invites you to their 22nd annual appreciation event on Saturday, February 25th. Purchase your tickets online at bvaam.org. Your home for Aggie baseball is 1150 AM and 93.7 FM. Your home for Aggie softball is Gospel 97.3 FM. You can hear both online at RadioAggieland.com. That's your community calendar. I'm Chelsea Reber on The Zone.
Everybody's talking about regenerative medicine now because, well, it works, and because people who have joint pain are getting real, lasting relief without drugs or surgery. Hey, it's David Nuño, and QC Kinetics is the nation's leader in this exciting treatment. They use highly concentrated healing agents from your own body to restore and repair damaged joint tissue. If you've got ongoing joint pain from arthritis or injury, you need to call QC Kinetics. Don't assume that steroids or surgery are your only option. Times of change and regenerative medicine can get you moving again with no downtime. Stop taking the pain meds and discover the remarkable alternative that pro athletes have been using for years. Thanks to QC Kinetics, this amazing treatment option is now available for folks just like you and me who are sick and tired of joint pain. Don't put this off any longer. Spring is coming. You want to enjoy all that life has got to offer. Call QC Kinetics now. Get a free consultation with a local medical professional. That's QC Kinetics, 979-452-6000. That's 979-452-6000. QC Kinetics, 979-452-6000.
If you have a debit card, you're used to spending money. But what if your card actually ended up earning you money? That's not exactly normal, but that's what you can get at A&B. It's called Kasasa Cashback Checking. Don't mind the weird name. What you need to know is that it's a free account with cash rewards. Use your debit card for everyday purchases, and we'll pay you cash back every month. If that doesn't sound like normal banking, well, guess what? We're not a normal bank. So contact A&B today and ask for Kasasa or visit anb.com. Equal housing lender, member FDIC.
It's Larry Shelby, previously on the Paul Feinbaum Show.
Paul, I want to, whatever happened to that guy who used to call in from New Jersey to talk real fast? I don't hear from him anymore either. What happened to him?
AC?
Yeah, what happened to him?
I'm hoping he's been extradited back to wherever he's from.
It's the Paul Feinbaum Show, powered by Polaris Fun Center, 2 to 4 weekdays on The Zone.
We are TexAgs Radio. We are presented by David Gardner's Jewelers. We are here in the Rollo Insurance Studio. Let's go to the News and Social Center as we get ready for a little interview scheduled with Buzz Williams here in a moment. Billy Lucci walking in here. Let's go to Kay Nagley quickly and read this text from, is it Brent, class of 04.
Gotcha. It says, let me make sure. New coordinators with new blood at key positions. Let me get back to you on October.
Is that the talking about just the SEC okay. overall? We can talk about that because I think Buzz is calling in here now. Billy Lucci joining us. Good morning, Billy.
David Nuño.
How was your weekend, buddy?
It was good. How was yours?
It was good. It was real good. It was really good watching the Aggie basketball team. That was the best part of it.
It's fun to kind of build your weekend around these A&M basketball games, yep. whether it's home or you're watching road games on TV. It's just fun right now for everybody. What I like the most is how much fun it is for those guys in the locker room. You get to see because what's gone into that getting there, not just in the off season, but also throughout Buzz's tenure here yep. in year four, but also, you know, this season in and of itself with the way it started, kind of the way they hung in and have not just turned things around, but, I mean, this has been – again, it is very similar to what we saw on the baseball diamond last yeah. year. They just had to find themselves and play the basketball that they're capable of playing and believe in it and you know, stick to it during the rocky portions of it. And now here's the payoff for as long as they can keep that together. But it's like I said, once you find yourself in one of these sports, as long as it's not football, because injuries tend to derail that so much. If you, the longer you play, there's a direct correlation, but now with there's no reason that they won't do this until the dance ends.
Yep. Let's go to the hotline because Buzz Williams is there joining us here in the morning. Buzz, good morning. How are you, sir?
Good morning. How you doing?
I'm doing well, Coach. So
what's up, Buzz?
Let's talk about what you learned about your team leading into this Georgia game, because you made a comment that you changed some things around with the kind of scheduling that you had. And at shoot-around, you felt really good about where the team was mentally and physically.
Well, we changed what we typically do on Thursdays just because the previous 10 days had been a lot different, right? We had three out of our previous four had been on the road, and then the transition from Wednesday, Saturday to Tuesday, Saturday. The first and the third of those games were on the road. Both of them had travel. We got home from Auburn at 4 o'clock in the morning on a Thursday morning. And then the experience that we had going to and from Arkansas on Monday and Tuesday, we didn't get home till 4 o'clock Wednesday morning. So we kind of altered what we typically do, David, on Thursday, just because our guys had been through a lot. That was not different than any other team, but it was just more than normal. And our guys handled Thursday as a first rep in a very mature way. I thought that bled into our typical one day before on Friday was really good. And then I felt really good at shoot around. And I think our guys felt really good at shoot around. So that was the adjustment. I don't know that it was right or wrong, but I knew that we needed to do something different after what we had been through the previous 9 days. And I think it ended up working out pretty well.
Yeah, it worked out. You know, it's rare that you go into Reed Arena or any sport in the SEC, and I know you guys were sweating it, but as a fan, to sit there and feel comfortable from wire to wire that Texas A&M was going to come out on top, that was elite basketball against an SEC opponent, which, you know, again, that's anytime you can get that. But I was going to ask you, Buzz, this is before you came on, I was talking about just the journey, the climb here at A&M. And as someone that came in, you knew so much about this place as opposed to other places you've coached. I mean, you literally had been here. I think it's the first stop probably that you've had where you were intimately familiar with the place, even though there was a lot of time in between, right? You knew, I think, just like every coach in this part of the country, in the South, knows that it truly is an if you build it, they will come type of situation. It really is. Whether we want it to be or not, the fans come when they embrace the team, and when the wins come, the fans grow. And this, I noticed it during the Christmas break, even one or two of those games. How good does it feel as a head coach and for your players when you guys come out and those student sections are packed that early? And how rewarding is it for you guys as a staff and a program to see kind of really grassroots-wise turn Reed Arena into such an intimidating venue? And I can't imagine what it's going to be like Tuesday night.
Yeah, I think your word grassroots is the best part of it, right? I know there's a lot of coaches that do a lot of different things from a marketing standpoint, and I respect that. And in many respects, I think that's probably what you're supposed to do. I'm just terrible at it. And I think I try to give my energy and my emotion to our guys and to our staff. And I just become so secluded. Like most coaches, you don't even really know what's going on outside of the very small world that you live in. And I mentioned this a couple of weeks ago when you could feel the groundswell. You could feel the grassroots, as you said. I think what resonates the most is, I think, how we're trying to play, how we're trying to compete, the spirit in which we play, the way that we love one another. I think you can feel that, whether you know our players, whether you know our coaches, whether you even understand basketball. You can tell that it's a team, and you can tell the team is pulling in the same direction, and you can tell the manager has ownership, and you can tell that the walk-on is really important, and you can tell that everybody has a role and has accepted that role, and they want to do their best. And I think that because of my knowledge, institutional knowledge, if that's what it's called, like, I think this community, I think this institution, I think the 12th man, I think they understand.
Yeah.
And I think the greatest currency is not money. The greatest currency is respect. And I think that they respect how we're going about it. And I think that, I mean, I go out there 60 minutes before the clock for 14 minutes to make sure that it's just part of my routine. But I don't want to go so fast, Lucci, that we take any of that for granted, because it is work, and it is all of the words that coaches would say when you're building something. It's hard to get to this point, and we're very thankful in a genuine way for the young people in the end zones, for them being early. We're really grateful for the old people that have season tickets. We're really grateful for all of the people in between who maybe don't have enough money or only bought a ticket or bought a package of tickets. Like, it's the culmination of all of it. Everybody has a role. And I think that it changes the environment at Reed. I think we won against Vanderbilt because in the second half, our crowd just pushed us emotionally. Hey, man, y'all got to keep going. You can't stop. And you could feel that in their clap. You could feel that in their cheers. And it's fun. And I do think that our guys appreciate it. They're thankful for it. And, you know, like, when you grow up and you're like, hey, I dream that I can do this. You dream of that sort of environment. And so to be able to live in that dream, that's a unique experience.
I got a couple thoughts on that, Buzz, that I'll save for when you're off. A couple of things about that. Why I think this team and your program has resonated with A&M fans. I'll give you the short version. I just think Texas A&M fans,
sure,
they want to see a team that when they watch them, no matter the sport, you feel like, man, these guys and this coaching staff, they want to win more than we do, because A&M fans are passionate. Yep. They want to win. And when we can watch a team that you know, okay, these guys want it worse than us, then win, lose, or draw, you walk away going, I was proud of the effort. And if you win, then you're doubly excited. But it makes you want to go back and support them. And they're a likable group, as you know.
Yeah, I think the character of our group, because of how their parents raised them, is a big portion of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that because their character is what it is, they're very receptive to, we need to work every day, and there's an opportunity to improve in each category of our operation. But I do agree with you, and I mean this with zero ego whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
I think that people cheer for anybody that tries really hard. And I think people admire and maybe at times are inspired by a group of people that care a lot. And that's one of the things that I talk to our team about. Like, there's so many intangibles. There's more intangibles that affect the tangibles than tangibles that affect the intangibles. And like, how hard you try, that's not a stat. And how much you care, that's not a stat. But like, we show our kids after every game, we call them care clips. Like, how much do you care? And we know what care means, but like, do your words and your life match up? Like, I know you say you care, but are you showing that? And I think because of the character of our players, they show how much they care, and they are trying really hard. And I want to, as you mentioned, I try to stay off the result, because just because you try hard and just because you care a lot, that's almost the price of admission in this league. But having said that, it's a prerequisite in this league. If you don't try really hard and you don't care a lot, you're not going to win. And so I think that the community, wherever they are and wherever they come from, I think that they know that we care. I think that they know that we're trying. And, like, in a very humble way, it, like, it means a great deal to me, not because it's I'm the head coach. It just means a great deal because that's, to me, that's the greatest story to tell. Yeah. Are we the best team? No. Do we have the most talent? No, sir. Were you tweeting about our recruiting classes? No. Mm-hmm. What about our staff? I don't know, man. I think that guy's been with Buzz a long time. Like, there's not a person, including me, that you go, that's the one. It's the collective group. Like, hey, well, Mo got hurt. Well, Solo got hurt. Hey, this guy's in foul trouble. Hey, this guy, man, he played really good. Well, next guy, what about this? Like, it's the group. And I think that the symmetry and the connectedness of our group, regardless if they're in uniform or in a suit and tie, everybody can sense that. And I think that that's really, really cool.
Yeah, no doubt. No doubt. Well, Buzz, this tomorrow night, a big one. The fans will be out. It'll be a
huge
monster game against, it was the first against three teams that you guys have already, four, first against four you've already played. That's what I was really wanting to ask you, and we'll ask you that during the press.
Yeah, well, it's a half a month of mirror games. The next 4 games, obviously, the next 2 weeks are all the second round of mirror opponents. A huge mini 4-game stretch here. Huge.
Yeah, no question about it. We'll see you tomorrow night. Thanks a lot, Buzz.
Thanks, Buzz.
Thank you so much. Have a good day.
You too. Right, you too. Buzz Williams are on the hotline.
The hotline.
One of
the
big things, game tomorrow.
Huge game.
Golly.
One thing I was going to ask him, but I probably shouldn't have asked him, I'll ask you. Is Dexter Dennis the best dunker on the team? Good God,
I think
that guy
so.
Can dunk.
Yeah, I think so. And I love, you know, listen, I was wondering that before the year. Because Q was so nasty with it. And you go back over these years of some of the most fun A&M teams, right? You think about the tournament teams. Maybe those very first ones didn't have anyone too crazy. Logan would probably come in.
Hold that thought.
And argue. But I want to talk about, some of the top dunkers. Because A&M's had some the really good A&M teams have had some great ones.
That's Billy. I'm David. We'll be back.
And don't you dare.
Grab your first cup of coffee weekday mornings with Keyshawn, J. Will, and Max. Powered by WC Tractor right here on 1150 AM and 93.7 FM. Plus, online at RadioAguiland.com. WC Tractor, your local award-winning Kubota in New Holland. Do you have questions? Look them up online at WCTractor.com. That's WCTractor.com. You can also call them at 1-888-8-TRACTOR. That's 1-888-8-TRACTOR. Keyshawn. J. Will. And Max.